Legendary comedian Billy Crystal is joining us live in just a moment. Here's a clip of Crystal and Larry together on the show. Watch this.
Billy, hi.
Hi.
I've been a fan of yours since the 70s. I think you're marvelous and you are brilliant.
Oh.
I'd like to know, how do you keep coming up with this wildly brilliant and hysterical material after all this time?
Yeah, because material, it's a fair question. It's hard to explain. But material in a medium like this one, or movies where you're on, when you do as much as you do, usually eats itself up.
I tell you, if this was baseball, I'd say I'm on a hitting streak. I don't know where things come from sometimes. I was once, like the idea for City Slickers, I was watching a television show about fantasy vacations, you know, and there was scuba diving you could do and go down a raft, the Colorado River, and I have a pad pretty much in every room, and just in case I get some of these little epiphanies, and I wrote City Slickers at the top of the page.
Really? Those two words?
Yeah, I wrote the title. I wrote three friends go on a cattle drive. Friends, just pretty much how I described the story. I even wrote Jack Palance's name in like half a page of legal pad.
That is unexplainable.
And then it just comes.
Billy Crystal is joining us now on the phone. Billy, it's so great to have you be part of this conversation as we remember the life of Larry King and his legacy. You've been interviewed by the great Larry King, but I know you also knew him off the air as well. When you think of him, what goes through your mind?
I think of Larry as really sort of like a relative. He sounded like a relative. He was funny. He was charming. He was very smart. And he was a regular guy. We could talk about politics. We could talk about comedy. We could talk about bagels. We could talk about anything. And I think that Larry's passing he's part of a senior class, Anna, of really enduring legends that we've been losing steadily. I mean, Hank Aaron just the other day, and my very dear friend Carl Reiner and Regis Philbin and Kirk Douglas, really giants who sustained themselves into their 90s. And so it's a sad day, but what an amazing career in that, you know, he was on CNN for 25 years, but the reason you can do that is because people trusted him.
Mm-hmm.
And you wanted to be interviewed for, I remember the first time I was interviewed with him, I really felt like I had arrived. I mean, I was starting to do movies, and you started to do press tours, you know. And then they said, Larry King wants to talk to you. And I was like, oh. And I was actually quite nervous because it was just Larry at the desk, no audience, so that was a little bit of an away game for me. And it was just a conversation that he actually made me relaxed because he was just so prepared, no notes. He just talked. And I think he was also very aware, and you'll know this too, as a broadcaster, the timing of the segment that you have. So the next question was right there. He didn't have to think about anything. And that kept me on my toes and made me respect him even more. He always was ready.
Yeah, I think all of us in this business have so much respect for, as you point out, his quick ability to come up with a question without notes. If you saw my desk, I have a ton of pages in front of me. I always come prepared, I think, but he had this ability to just listen so intently and ask the question that popped into his head, perhaps, because he was so innately curious. I want to take another look at a clip of you on Larry's show, and then we'll talk on the other side.
Okay.
You got to be happy with the way the basketball scenes turned out.
Well, you know, the guys are so great. And we have Charles Barkley and David Robinson, the MVP, and Kareem and Isaiah, Bill Laimbeer, Chris Mullin, Reggie Miller. And I think it's the best work that Reggie Miller's ever done.
It is. And by the way, I heard today from John Feinstein that Reggie Miller took 2 days off camp to shoot that, and that Larry Brown was ticked.
Well, he should have been. I only needed Reggie for half an hour. The other two days... I don't know where he was. I don't know where he was. Cato doesn't know where he was. We just have no idea where he was.
Billy, you said he could talk about anything. I know you're a big New York Yankees baseball fan. Tell me about Larry King, the sports fan.
Well, Larry was a diehard Dodger fan. If anyone had watched any of the playoff games of the World Series in recent years, he'd be in the front row with his Dodger jacket and so on. So I actually got to play in an old-timers game. I was, you know, I had one major league at bat with the Yankees back in 2008 as a great favor from George Steinbrenner. So I had some street cred as a Yankee. So the Yankees were playing, and they had old-time Yankees here at Dodger Stadium, so they asked me to play to fill out the teams, and they were playing against the old-time Dodger teams, which were the great Steve Garvey, Ron Say, that group. So I'm at bat, and Larry King is the umpire. And I'm facing the immortal Fernando Valenzuela. And the first pitch is 2 feet away. I mean, it's high and 2 feet out of the strike zone. Larry says, strike one. So I turn and I said, Larry, what? And the next pitch, same place, strike two. So I step out and said, Larry, those weren't even close. And he says, I know, but I'm hungry.
Oh, that says so much about his personality, right?
You know, he was so fluent in so many things. You know, 2 years ago, Larry was kind enough to host an event in my honor at the Friars Club. It was a big fundraising event for the club, and he was the MC. And Anna, he was, and I've been with other events where he's spoken, and he, you know, because he was around comedians who he adored. And other show business people his entire life, it's felt like, that he picked up their rhythms. And he was able to perform really like a Borscht Belt comic in the best way. He had great timing and great rhythm. And it was really a lesson in being prepared. Again, you know, he didn't work from any notes or anything, just like he did when he was being interviewed. And he had, about 1,000 people to talk to. And He was a stunning human being.
No doubt about it. You talk about his quick wit and the fact that you said he could go toe-to-toe with other comedians, even though that wasn't his day job. Was it fun to go on his show as a comedian because he kind of would set you up to deliver the punch?
Well, yeah. He also was a little intimidating because you didn't know where he was going to go. And you didn't know what his approach would be. You know, you're coming on basically to talk about your latest project and so on and so forth. And he might have wanted to talk about something else. So, again, without an audience, it was almost like going into a shrink session or something, because there he was, you know, with the big glasses and just the way that he would sit there and look at you and he never looked at notes, and it just kept coming. So it was always a pleasure to be with him, but there was a little fear involved at times, because again, he didn't know where he was going to go. But it always ended up in the right place.
You know, his show was destination programming, and today we have so many different information outlets and media outlets and places to get information and entertainment, you know, with our smartphones and the internet. Do you think that, you know, his legacy is tied to an era where people wanted to be at home listening, and he was just such a great, great conversationalist?
I do, and I also think that it was of a different time. I may be wrong, of course, but I don't remember a lot of the phone calls that he would take, which were a big part of the show, with anyone calling with much animus. Anger seemed in the country seemed to be a lot less during that time. And of course, depending on who the guest was, but he would treat whoever called in with great dignity, and you felt like you were calling in, you know, to a friend. I also used to kid him, you talk about social media a little bit, that his column, he had a newspaper column that was sort of, in a way, a precursor of tweeting, because he would write these little one-sentence observations and tie them all together. And I used to kid him, I said, Larry, how is this a column? How is it? And he'd write, tomato soup and grilled cheese, still a great lunch on a snowy day. And that's writing? And he just would laugh big, you know. In my mind, Tony Bennett is still the greatest singer. And that was his entire column. So,
I'm sure he got a lot of opinions, though. I'm sure it sparked a lot of passion in people, some of those.
He did. And people wanted to talk to him. You know, sometimes I'd see him and I wouldn't even say, hi, Larry. I'd just go, Altoona, you're on. And he just would giggle. And then, you know, he was a real, I'll use the word Hamish, guy. Mm. And like Regis and Carl Reiner, to have a career that long and be that good for that long is something we all should be grateful for and aspire to.
I think it says that he was just so passionate. He lived and breathed the work that he did. It was, in some ways, I imagine, effortless for him, the fact that he wanted to work all the way up to his death because he loved it so much. Billy Crystal, thank you very much for sharing your memories and your thoughts and your perspective on the life and legacy of Larry King.
Thank you.